this is Aaron Squire coming to you guys again. We've got episode 117, and of course I forgot what I called it again, but something PVE is how we're going to get our stuff, because we're going to talk about some PVE that's going on. Should probably turn down my cell phone, so, you know, she used to call me on it, but, you know, it makes a little bit too much noise for when we're running the show. Anyways, tonight on the show, we're going to talk about some of the VIP weekend that's happening right now this weekend. We're going to talk about the end of the season. We're going to talk about some of the stuff in the Radiant Rumble, that the top eight deck lists that made it. Not mine on that one. Had a pretty bad day that day. And I don't know exactly what I'm going to build, really. Like, it's been a fairly busy week at work the last couple weeks, and it's finally calmed down, so it's good to be back, and it's good to just hang out and talk about Hex again. So let's go ahead and just dive right into what's going on here. I think tomorrow I was planning on doing a lot of, like, I was planning on doing some modeling tomorrow, but we'll see what happens. Some modeling in Blender, that is, you know, not some. Anyways, so the VIP weekend's this weekend, so if you haven't, you know, if you're not playing it now, then you might want to think about it if you paid for VIP. If you haven't, you can always pay for VIP and get your tickets that way and start playing VIP. It's got some pretty cool alternate arts. We have one for Rizix, another one for Righteous Vanquisher. Vanquisher has been one that hasn't seen a lot of play. Maybe we should try to build some sort of Vanquisher deck. The problem is that the body for the price just feels like it's suboptimal. It does have Assault, and it's in Diamond, so we'd have to build something, some sort of Diamond Assault deck. That might be a challenge. Maybe we'll try to do that. It's definitely something that's not going to be Tier 1, but it might be a good, you know, a good thing we can try out. We haven't tried anything like that yet. Next, we've got Chronicles of Entrath. Chapter 2 is coming. That's fairly exciting for a lot of people that have done PvE. Honestly, I still haven't finished the campaign. I've been working on a lot of college work, and of course work itself has gotten in the way, and I have my fourth son, so no excuses. I need to finish the Chronicles of Entrath, basically the first part of Adventure Zone 1. I did make it a couple of extra zones in there just because I know if I finish the dungeons, I was going to have a chance at getting some of those PvE cards. And we do have that all the way through the rest of October, so I might try to do that this weekend as well. But coming with Adventure Zone 2, we've got some mercenaries, which we've been long awaited for since the Kickstarter campaign. So pretty excited to see how those are going to work. And we're not sure exactly what they're going to look like. The last thing I heard about mercenaries is that it was going to be almost like not really a side or reserves for your deck in PvE, but like if you're stuck in a dungeon, you can call on the mercenary to come in and kind of like bail you out, and it's an alternate deck that you can run a whole nother deck with your mercenary in it, who will have his own charge powers that you can do like once per dungeon or maybe twice per dungeon or something like that. We're also getting a new ranger class, so it says hunt for new ways to play with a brand new talent tree, passive and champion power, so we're getting a whole new class. I think we've got, what, 6 of the 9 or 10 classes that they wanted to have right now. I'm not sure exactly on that one. So, but it's always exciting to see new things. I still haven't even played with all the classes. I have a mage and I have a warrior. So, I don't know. I should probably get into doing some of that as well. There's so much to do in Hex. You're really not going to run out of time, even for the free to, or run out of things to do, even for the free to play players. And then we're going to get, of course, a whole new chapter, a whole new zone. The word on the streets is that it's going to be some sort of dreadling based zone, possibly. And then we've got, of course, we've got new dungeons. We're going to delve into 4 new lush dungeons and wrestle with some awesome loot and get those, you know, creatures that dwell within the dungeon. So should be a great time when we get this Adventure Zone 2. The only thing I'd say about the old dungeons is they kind of felt like I haven't played the very last one. I've played 3 out of the ones that are in the current campaign, and they felt like it was very limited as far as the number of fights that you would do in there, and I wasn't too interested to do them again after I did them one time. So Part of that is just because, I guess I'm not grinding a lot of equipment. Maybe if I did that and I was looking for a specific piece of equipment, I would do it, but, that has limited appeal to me as well, so. Moving on, we've got the Chronicles of Entrath, Chapter 2, Welcome to the Next Level. I'm just going to say Jared so I don't mess up his, so I don't butcher his last name. Is talking about this one. So this is one of the exciting things about this is that we are getting PVE packs that you can buy with gold. So you can earn gold in PVE, then you can buy packs, and some of the cards in the packs are rather common cards from any of the sets that are currently available, which is going to put more common cards into circulation, which is going to drive prices down on the auction house, which makes them more accessible to people that are trying to get all the staples for their deck built out. Of course, we're getting ready fairly soon in about two sets to rotate sets 1 and 2, so that will be very interesting when that happens, and we'll have our first eternal format that we may be playing. So we'll see what happens. I do think that there's a very good chance that we're going to see Titania's Majesty come back in the Eternal formats, but we'll see. It depends on if it gets super oppressive again. It's hard to say what it would do in the current format, but they're not bringing it back. That's definitely not happening. So there's a new leveling system that's coming out, which is pretty neat, that I just read about before the show. So you're going to be able to level up your account, and the reason why they're doing this is so that you can feel an overall sense of progression as you step through the game. And this isn't going to be something that's just arbitrary, because there's going to be rewards that are actually tied to this. So here you go. It's basically you get rewards per day. There's going to be an XP or an experience cap every day, so you can see how this person's bar is gray and then it's blue, meaning that you can actually earn XP for that day. So this is going to hopefully slow down all those people that just like grind through all the XP within 2 or 3 days, and they can kind of spread it out a little bit. Of course, there's nothing stopping them from playing Hex, but this, if you want to do well, they want to limit it. They don't want it, Hex to completely dominate your time. They want you to have fun with it and not overwhelm yourself and get burnt out by it. And some of these sleeves, man, I really like this castle one. That's probably my favorite one. I like I like this one, number one, number two, and number three, as far as the sleeve. So I'm excited to level up my account. It seems like it's going to be a really good thing to do. All right, next item on the docket. I got the cat in here. She's jumping. She always bugs me. She knows when the show is on, she can just get away with stuff. So I just wanted to talk about some of these decks that we saw in the Radiant Rumble, because obviously I didn't do extremely well. I could have played the Kagu Crusader deck. That was one that I considered playing, but I wanted to do something that was kind of interesting, and so I felt like the deck that we had was going to be at least decent enough. Had some pretty bad pulls. I went down to 6 cards quite a few times. I think over the time I went down to 5 with a 23 shard deck. I think that honestly, like, one of the things that really hosed me was listening to my viewers and putting Underworld Crusaders in that deck. Even though it's a good card, it really hurt me on my reserves after reserves, and it really hurt the overall deck, because Kagu Crusader wants to be played on 2, and in order to do that, I would need to play the Dork, the Howling Brave, which wasn't really going to be an option for the deck that I was playing, which is a Blood Wild variant, which ran a lot of Dreadlings and that sort of thing. I think it ran a lot better the way I originally had it. But anyways, this is a fairly interesting deck. He's got a lot of the typical things we're seeing. He's playing a full playset of Cottontail Explorers. I guess he really wants to get those resources out. And also, this does a lot for the deck, because it throws stuff into your crypt, which can get raised back with your champion power. He's got double Crocosaur, which seems like a fair choice. The one Exarch of the Egg. Of course, he needs a total of 10, Underworld troops. It's really like 9 if you don't count Underworld Crusader, because he counts as one of them. So he's got an Inquisitor in here, which he's got with Blood of Sacrifice, where he can sacrifice a troop and make it bigger. So that's pretty awesome. He's got Hierophants with cultivation, so you can get some resources and frenzy on them. So speed frenzy, that's a fairly interesting choice on those ones. I'm surprised he didn't set up one of them with the sacrifice and the it can't be blocked. And then his Underworld Crusader, of course, has the Skyguard Steadfast. Yeah, it's really interesting that he did so well without the typical things we see in Hierophant finishing out the games. I guess this makes it less of a threat, and so people just let it go by for a little while. They aren't as threatened by it. It's got a Fentio in here, which, of course, is really good against the the control matchup. He doesn't have one in the reserves to go up to two. I think I would have, if I'm going to run Fentio, I think I would have run a second one, but I'm sure it worked for him. Podvyakuzan, of course, is just good removal. Munara Sensei is just that extra card draw, and it's another troop that you need. And Mistress of Bone was one that they talked about a lot in the let's credit him properly. Chris Van Meter wrote this article on the Hex website, but yeah, like Mistress of Bone was one that people went back and forth about, and I found a home for it here. At 7, it seems like it might be ridiculously expensive, but it does bring back a lot of stuff, and when you combo it with the Cottontail Explorer plus the Champion Power, you have a lot of options that you can bring back. It's not bringing back any dwarves, like he says here. I think that, it's one of those things as a deck builder I always have a hard time with. I always want to utilize every single part of my cards, and so sometimes you just got to let some things go with that. But you're getting a 5/7 body, and you're getting a Venom and a Shin Hair back, so we could get back Inquisitor if it got countered or something, or if it's just ends up in the crypt. Can't bring back the Underworld Crusader, but you can bring back Hierophant. He can bring back Yakuzan, which is pretty ridiculous. Paw is pretty good for the extra removal. Even if he just needs to draw a card, Sensei would be okay. Although that seems like that late in the game, it seems like not so much of a thing. It's also running Heart of the Wrathwood, which we haven't seen too many people play of recently. This is another card that gets really, really big. And then when it dies, because you Extinction or something, then it kind of keeps board state for you. With all the seed pods that come into play and then eventually get out of hand for your opponent. Also, he's playing the Extinction in here, and he's playing a deck which actually is okay to Extinction away your own board because you have some recovery out of your crypt with a lot of these cards. And Rotten Rancor is another good one, bringing those troops back, battling troops. He's really just playing with that crypt to the fullest extent. I'm not sure that Closed Coffins would really be something that he couldn't deal with in this deck. Closed Coffins itself seems like it's really good versus the Kagu deck. Of course, that means you're in Blood. You're probably playing maybe Blood Sapphire for control or something, but seems pretty interesting. Probably the Ruby matchup is one of the worst ones for this deck, which a lot of people have talked about. That's probably where you pull your Underworld Crusaders and trade them for like Carnosaurus, something like that. Extinction, of course, versus the aggro matchups. A lot of the diamond matchups, probably Extinction comes in. Gemborn Prowler, again, versus other Hierophants or other Underworld Crusaders. So it's in the mirror match, seems pretty good. Grove Warden, I don't know exactly how good this guy is. I haven't actually had to play him against someone, so I don't know. Transforming artifacts and constants into seed pods, maybe that's good. Steel Intel, though, I've seen do some real work against a lot of players. And then, of course, we've got Uranus as a classic from set one, and Winds of Change. Yeah, that seems all right. I don't know. I don't know we're seeing this many constants. I feel like I would rather just run the whatever it is, this two resource instant speed removal when it's constants and artifacts, but I don't know. Maybe he probably knows something I don't. Anyways, Joe Zimmers, moving on to the next deck in the lineup. We've got basically the mono wild deck that's been going around. Some of the pretty interesting cards that I see in here, like Justicar. It feels like this card is just kind of vanilla, but I've had this thing cast for 6 on me. It can't be interrupted, and it's an 8/8 body that just, it gets a little bit frustrating to deal with. Of course, Master Moss is always good value. Hierophant, we know. Might Singer of Angels. This just has a lot of cards which are just like, please deal with me or die type of things. Only 2 Crocosaur in here. Again, Crocosaur is not seen as much play as it used to see, but I don't think I would fault anyone for going up to three of those. A four Chlorophylia, Crocosaur Dreamweaver, Gargolith is another one versus a lot of those very aggressive removal type decks. Harvest Moon, sure. Well, I guess this is versus the aggro matchup. Maybe that's pretty good. Lullaby is another interesting choice. I suppose that's maybe against, let's see, anyone that's running, what is it called? Mass Polymorph Dingler is probably for that. Nature Reigns. There we go. Nature Reigns. I think I would rather have Nature Reigns than the other one, but because I like the quick action speed of it. And then, of course, Cluckodon versus. So he's got Cluckodon and four Carnosaur. So it feels like he's really ready for that Ruby matchup. I think that's where this deck really shines, is in that Ruby matchup. It's just, it's likely that they're just not going to be able to keep up with the healing that you can output, along with the beats and then these massive bodies that you can throw on the field. You should gas them out. Next, we've got Shinshire. This one is super interesting to me because this is kind of what I was doing with the Dreadlings in my deck, but this is definitely quite a bit better. Emperor's Lackey is, and what's the other one in here? The Guru of the Wounded Petal were two cards that feel like they're just maybe too difficult to play, but he just found a way to make them really work in this deck. Guru is one that definitely I feel like is the power card. As far as the low end, that's just not seeing a lot of play right now. It's fairly accessible for people to try to get. And he's running main deck Withering Touch. I guess that's for all the Chlorophylia and maybe for the Hero Fall that's out there. Hero Fall, Chlorophylia, that's probably for a lot of that. Of course, it works really well against any of your decks that are featuring, Sapphire. The Sapphire draw, any basically Sapphire draw cards, Withering Touch works really well against, so there's always that. And when you can stop them from drawing cards, eventually you can win the card for card battle. But lots of course, a lot of Shinhair in the deck. Monsoon, I think, is really shining in the format. I think that he's definitely one that we're going to see a lot more of, especially when you've got Well of Agents plus Lily Pad. That just seems like the perfect storm of things to have in here. Let's see, he's got 14, what is that, 18. He's only running 21 resources, so he's running a super low curve. Looks like the top of his curve is really 3. Well, I guess he's got a Paw of Yak, 2 Paw of Yakazan, so that's really like 4. He's got 2 cards that cause 4. Oh, he's got a Gemborn Prowler as well. Yeah, Gemborn Prowler is really starting to pick up. I think Armies of Mordor was definitely right about that one. Again, the deck's running the Dormant one / Unbound one, which is also kind of interesting in here. An Incantation of Savagery. Yeah, I think I did lose to Shinshire or a deck like this when I was playing the Radiant Rumble, so that's fairly interesting as well to me. And, of course, there's the Mono Ruby Burn deck, which runs the champion that just deals 4 to your face, Angus the Arsonist. Pretty general. I think that I also lost to this one because I got Lasgard Vengeance, and it just blew out my whole board state. I mean, 4 to each opposing champion and troop. The champion thing I can get past, but the 4 to each troop, like, this card says no to one of the best wild cards versus the matchup, which is what's it called? Your Succulent Cluckodon, because 4 toughness is what you're depending on your opponent not to be able to deal with, and then the 4 health hopefully gets you above where it is that you need to be to get that to happen. But when they're running Lasgard's Vengeance, it can really just close out a game. If they have like one Psychotic Arsonist on the board, and they can swing in, deal 4 to your face with Lasgard's Vengeance and kill most of your board state, yeah, you're probably in really bad shape at that point, so good luck pulling that one out. And that was it with all of those things. There was one other Hex update I did want to talk about, and I'm trying to remember exactly what it was. Let's go down. Here we go. Let's talk about the Monster Mash real quick. So it's Haunted Harvest. They talk about that quite a bit. They are looking for a UI artist. That's actually something that's funny enough. I'm actually working on the UI for my game quite a bit. But just for logging in this month, you get your Haunted Harvest sleeve, which is it's all right. I'm not a really big fan of this sleeve. I do really like this Dread Harvest alternate art, so I'm hoping to get a full play set of these. I guess they're calling them Corn Huskers for the for the Dreadlings. It's funny. It would be funny if it makes Dreadlings that look like that. I kind of hope that it does. And then, of course, if you play the PVE, you're going to get Stingy Jack, and you'll get his PVE equipment. So this is what I was trying to get. I think I got one of them by playing three dungeons, so that's not too bad. And there's his. They give you percentages on what the chances are of pulling his equipment, so that's pretty good. And they don't make the extra. They don't make the Cornhusker guys. Okay, well, we can hope. Maybe someone can ask them about that, or maybe someone can pitch it to them, or maybe they're actually watching the they'll watch the show later and they'll be like, yeah, that's a great idea, Aaron Squire. Let's go ahead and make these into, you know, whenever Dread Harvest makes these, or during Halloween, it makes them into guys that look like that. They already have the picture. Just take this picture and just throw it on the throw it on the Dreadlings, right? That should be fairly easy to do. Okay, so I said we're going to make that Angel deck. I think we're going to go for a Righteous Vanquisher. We're going to try it. We'll see what we can do with Righteous Vanquisher. Not going to be a competitive deck tonight, so apologies for that. Tomorrow, I'll probably be playing something, honestly, probably something from the deck list that we saw that Chris Van Meter was so good to post for all of us. Not sure exactly which shards we're going to be in, but we're definitely in Diamond, so we'll check that one in Shardless, and we'll just think about some stuff. I think we're probably going to have to just go ahead and run our Marshal Josephina, because it seems like if we were going to be attacking with a lot of stuff, exhausting one of our opponent's things so that way we can push damage past stuff is a great idea. So we'll go ahead and run your typical Marshal Josephina, and many people think that this is probably one of the best Diamond champions that you can be running right now. It has the highest life total of a competitive champion that you can be playing right now. 25 seems to be about the cap out for life totals on champions, and you know, this is just so interesting because they say that they didn't want to, you know, if it's a powerful effect, they wanted it to be closer to 20 or sometimes less than 20, but if it's a you know, not so powerful effect, they want it to be over 20, you know, like closer to 24 25. So it's really interesting to see that Marshal Josephina has 25 health on her as being such a powerful card as it is. It seems like if we're going to be pushing stuff, maybe we want to just go straight up tempo with our deck, try to do something like that, some maybe flying tempo or just evasive tempo type of a deck, or just things that are just unblockable. Maybe we should just look up all the unblockable stuff and then go into Sapphire. I think that Sapphire might be the best choice for us. Let's look at let's look at maybe what kind of support we can get from other shards. Now we can run the human shard, so that's kind of a big deal. We also have Shard of Purpose, which is, it comes into play exhausted, and I did believe, yeah, we've got Well of Purpose. So because we've got Well of Purpose, Shard of Purpose, and the Human Shard, I think that Diamond Sapphire is going to be our best bet, because we can just, we'll just have a great base to start off from with all of those things that we can just throw right in the deck, just slot them right in there. Of course, if you don't have your Wells of Life, you can always just substitute something else like Shards of Fate, or something else, but you should be able to get your Shard of Purpose fairly easily. I think you can get all these in the PvE campaign now. And the other one is the Human Shard. And that one, I mean, I'm not sure exactly how expensive it is going for. Let's see what things are going for right now. Well of Life is probably the more expensive one, showing that it is about 250, which is, I think that's reasonable for a resource. Honestly, $250 is fine, because that's, you know, $10, you've got your playset, so that's not too bad. And the other one's going to be less, the Carloth Cobblestone, which is, if you have Human Allegiance, you can play this for Diamond or Sapphire, which is all we'll play it for. This one's actually more expensive, probably because that set isn't being played as much anymore. Primal Dawn is not being opened as much, so maybe that's why it's more Or maybe it's because Jeff Hoagland is playing his deck, and so people are getting excited about humans. Playing some sort of Diamond X humans. So maybe that's why. Who knows? Let's look for things that are unblockable, I think. Maybe we should start there. Unblockable. So we've got our Eldritch Dreamer, which is a classic. This guy has really fallen out after we lost our old gems, where he just doesn't... he's not as cool just because we can't attack in, deal damage, and draw a card. And, you know, he isn't unblockable for that. He is fairly expensive at 4 as well. Let's see, what else have we got? We got this ridiculously expensive Poet of Glacky. Says, when Chaos Touch deals damage to opposing champion, bury the top shard. And... put that card in your hand, and this guy's unblockable, and he's Chaos Touched. Yeah, this just feels like that's not going to be what we want. Of course, Shoggoth has seen a little bit of play as like a one of in control decks. I don't know that he's going to go in this type of a tempo deck, though. Let's see, what else have we got? Veiled Lurker is unblockable, and if we have triple Sapphire, we get +1/+1. Marshal Josephina is only mono one diamond, so this might be something we could try. The problem is it costs 4. I think if this costs 3, then I would have to definitely try it out. But at 4 for a 3/3 unblockable, I don't know. I feel like the Eldritch Dreamer is definitely doing more for us than this guy, because most of the time he's going to be a 2/2 a lot of the time. So I don't know that I can pick that guy up. Rizix is another one, but of course this puts us into blood, which is not going to really work for us, so I'm not even really going to look at him. Also, he kind of wants you to put things in your opponent's crypt, so either kill stuff or, you know, not really mill, but bury their stuff. You know, try to use the hex terms for things. Okay, so we'll consider some Eldritch Dreamer for now. If we've got him in the deck, let's see, what can we socket into him? We could create true dreadlings and put them into play, which seems to be not that much fun. Let's see, we've got Enfeeblement. When this attacks, target opposing... Okay, so I like Enfeeblement on this guy. I think that that's going to be pretty sick, because this is going to allow us to attack and then prevent damage. So this could be a big deal with our Eldritch Dreamer. So let's go ahead and try that out on this guy. So he's got the Enfeeblement, which is, I think that's pretty cool. We've got 12 shards in the deck, so we do have to remember that when we're counting up our cards. In fact, I'll just go ahead and put the rest of the resources in here. Let's just put in just an arbitrary amount of Diamond and Sapphire, and we'll fix that later. Let's see, where are you? Diamond shards. Come on, Diamond Shards and Sapphire Shards. You know what, let's make the cards a bit bigger. That will help everybody see them better. And Sapphire. Yeah, apologies for not doing that ahead of time. It's just been one of those weeks, you know. One of them weeks. So we've got 12 shards plus 8 shards is 20 shards. So let's just go ahead and just make it an even 20. So I'll just put one of these up to more. Now, this is not the shard base that we want for the deck right now. We haven't worked that out. We're just doing that so we know how many cards we've got in the deck right now. And so 24 shards is probably fair for a deck like this. So what kind of tempo things can we really think about, really sink our teeth into for the deck? Now, we could try to do some dreadlings with some dwarves again. I'm not sure that I want to attempt that or not. I think I just want things that just bounce stuff. Reese, of course, is a classic, so we could think about him, although he'll take a fair bit of time. Eternal Sage is another one that's interesting to think about, at least. Maybe I think I've got something. I've got Sapphire. Yeah, that's what's happening. That's why I can't see all the cards. Yeah, I was just kind of look for ideas, really, at this point. It's helpful to know all the cards. I've kind of gotten behind on memorizing a lot of the cards that you have available to you in the game. I don't think we need Charge Bot. We don't need to get our champion power that badly. Let's see. We do want it. We want to basically just bounce our opponent's field. So maybe we just go back and play classic, the old classics, like, what's his name? The Buccaneer. Because the thing is, like, right now there are things that come into play that hurt us a lot, like a lot of the dinosaurs do. But Buccaneer does kind of hurt your... a lot of the what are they called? The knights that are in. Let's see, what are they called? They are Van Meter's article. Where are you? I had you up. I don't know where I put Chris Van Meter's article. It was just here. Anyways, all those knights that cost three, that is, they come into play and they don't do anything right away. They don't really have come into play abilities unless they're gemmed with it, and a lot of people aren't playing that. So bouncing those guys is great. Bouncing dinosaurs is really bad, but you get to choose, and sometimes you may not, you may just choose not to bounce, you know, your opponent's stuff. But still seems like that should be a fairly good card to have in the deck when you're trying to get damage in, or at least be able to swing and have your opponent not respond equitably to what you're doing. We could go back and play the Ancestors Chosen in here. I'm not sure that we want to do that, though. We could play the Diamond, the new Diamond guy. I forget what his name is. Oh, my goodness. I'm just losing it tonight. He's like a knight or whatever. It's not a knight. He's the set 5 diamond guy that makes spirits. Oh, my goodness. Everything's running really slow. We might think about that, though. We might think about running that guy. I'm not sure. I really want to make a deck for this guy. I started to attempt it at one point in time, but there's just the life drain and the life gain is just not there with the gem rotation. It's kind of sad, actually. But it does make for shorter games when, you know, that's what we have now. So I suppose it's better. Shorter games are better for most people. There's our Mass Polymorph Dingler. And there's Psychic Ascension, which we won't be playing in here. We probably won't actually play a lot of card filtering. We'll probably want to play this Silver Talon Adjudicator, though. That seems like a good choice here. Tempo gives us those cards. Seems pretty good. Yeah, that guy I did point out is being something that I thought that was going to be fairly amazing. Plus, we can bounce our own guy with all the bounce spells that we may be playing in here anyways. So that sounds like fun to me. We could just go back and play the old school Menacing Grulk as well. That could be interesting. Play our Mentalist. Mentalist could be interesting as well to draw those cards. So we do really want to draw cards off of our cards when they do swing in, like the Buccaneer and everything. And it does buff everything in the deck. There's our Lanipause site. That's another one that, you know, if you've got main decked cards that can help out with. Great. Let's see, when it comes into play, right? So this also, if we Lanipause site our own dudes, we can bounce dudes to draw cards, which seems pretty good going back to the to our thing. We probably want the Spearcliff Cloud Knights in the reserves for the Ruby matchup. I know that they die to every Ruby spell, but still, if they don't kill it, if it lives for X turns, then we're in pretty good shape. Royal Den Mother seems like a decent one as well to have in here. You bounce it, you get more dudes. That seems pretty good. Like a good idea. Hero of Legend. I've seen people play this guy. I really like him a lot. I love the... hey, what's going on, Torting? I like the fact that he has the stuff that buffs a lot of your Valorous stuff. So maybe if we get things out of the way, it makes it better for our Valorous troops. Hero of Legend seems pretty good. Hope Heart's another one I think I'd throw in the reserves these days. Extinction seems to have gone down to from a 4 of down to a 2 or 3 of in a lot of decks that run it. And so Hope Heart is really your answer to Extinction, or your, you know, you have to actually 2-for-1 me at least. Where is it? You are not really 2-for-1. You have to kill my Hope Heart Unicorn and then Extinction my board. So hopefully the card advantage is not as bad as it would be if you just Extinction. Of course, we have Ardent Crusader. That's what it is. Crusaders. That's what we want in the deck. So looks like I need to refresh the page, so we're going to do that right now. Not sure how many cards we've got in the deck now. So, again, this is not super competitive deck tonight that we're building on the show. We're just doing, of course, a lot of theory and crafting, which is what I love to do. I actually haven't built an amazing combo deck in a while either, so we may try to do that next week. Okay, so we need that Crusader for sure in the deck. I think we can do it. We can get the humans in the deck and space everything out enough. Oh, it looks like it shut off all my filters too. We've seen ruby cards, all kinds of stuff. Yeah, it shut off all my filters. Looks like we need to fix that, so we'll do that. So far, I like what I'm seeing with the deck. It's probably going to end up being very similar to what we've already seen a lot of other players do, being your Jeff Hoaglands of the Hex community. But I am trying to get that Angel to work, so we got to think about that as well with the deck. So I am trying to think about more tempo options, so that's probably where our spells are coming from. So we're just kind of building out our core of troops right now, and then we're going to build out tempoing stuff, which means we probably won't run actually transmogrified, because we actually need to tempo things out and not just turn them into other things. But maybe I'm making a mistake there. It's possible. Okay, let's get down to where it is that, you know, tempo or kill. That's really the thing here. All right, there's a paladin. Let's see. There's William Rowan. William Rowan might be okay. Okay, he's a classic, right? We want to get attacks in, right? Warparty guide's another one that might be interesting in here as well. So again, this is we're kind of taking a lot of cues from what Jeff Hoagland's already done. Time Ripple, I think, is going to be a big player in this deck. I've never been a huge fan of Time Ripple, but I do accept that it is a really good card. You know what might be interesting in here is running Waylay as well, if we can get enough attacks in early enough. We really need some really good one drops, and I remember Jeff was playing, there's a character that gets bigger every time you draw a card. I think it's this guy, Tomeseeker. So we probably want to play this one, and we can shift the ability, so that seems fairly strong. I'm guessing this guy is at least... No, it's not too bad. This is for Tomeseekers. That's less than a dollar. I mean, for the ability that's on it, it seems like something that could be really good and just get out of hand really, really quickly. There's an AA for it too. So it looks like, yeah, this is the AA. That's also just pennies. Pennies on the dollar for the AA version of this ridiculous. Not too ridiculous. It's a card that I've seen Jeff put to good use. We'll put it that way. All right, let's see here. So I said that we needed to get... So I've also seen Jeff bring to justice. I don't like this basic action speed, but it does remove things. Clash of Steel is another great one that we've seen. Chooses a card that control and void everything else. That one's going to be tough, though, with our deck. Now, we can always bounce things back to our hand and then Clash of Steel, so maybe that's, you know, kind of cute. Another thing you can do with the card is you can always bounce stuff on the block and then save your troops as well, which is pretty cool. Solitary Exile is just a catch-all, so we'll put two of those, and we can put maybe one or two of these in the reserves. There we go. There's our Ardent Crusader, which we wanted to put in the deck a minute ago when we had to refresh the website. And Hero of Legends already in there, and Hope Heart, again, I'm putting on the reserves. So we really just have to think about how we're tempoing, what's going to be happening in the early stages, like what's our optimal hand. A lot of times when you're playing card games, this specific card game or games that are similar to it, you're not going to see every card in your deck unless you're playing some sort of control, which is not what we're doing. You're going to see probably around, you know, 15 to 18 of the cards in your deck before either you lose or you win. So what is our optimal hand? What are we trying to curve out to? We really kind of need to have some strong turn one plays, so I think I need to go back and really consider some of that stuff. We might also look at the whatever his name is, guy, the what is it? He's an old school, let's just say draw, because I know it'll come up, draw cards. And that is going to be, yeah, here you go. Your Cerulean Mirror Knight is another big one that's kind of made a comeback here. Kind of a big deal. He draws cards. Warparty guy draws cards. So those guys both could do some work here if we can play them on two. And then we can, like, bounce things with our other support cards. Do we have any other one drops that we really want to play in here? I mean, the only one I can really think of is the human that throws spirits in your deck, and we may play one of him just because we need to meet requirements for our Crusader. I didn't pick a gem for the Crusader just yet either. One of the cards I don't like in here is Gust Mage. I understand he's good in limited because you kind of need to fill gaps and stuff, right? He gets that Valor into your hand. It just feels ridiculously slow. I'm not a big fan of Gust Mage. Now, it does say when he enters play and we are tempoing things and whatever and bouncing and all that fun stuff, but I still don't think it's good enough for this kind of a deck. So I would not suggest going with Gust Mage. I'd actually I'd rather play Bright Moon Brave over Gust Mage, even though it has flight, because we can bounce this guy and actually, I think, get a little bit more value out of him. Another target troop. Queen's Guard's another one that's a fan favorite for me, just because I feel like it might be able to work, but a lot of times it doesn't. Totem of Lanpa looks pretty interesting. Next troop in here gets one of the following, and this is a PvP card? That seems pretty sick. We might try that Totem guy. Yeah, PvP. Totem of Lanpa looks pretty sick for this deck, and I think he's also an Ardent troop, which is what we need, so this feels like the right card to have in here that we can just turn one this guy. So that seems pretty interesting. Of course, we also have Valiant Escort, which is another 2-1 that we can play, and then Cloud Runner is another 2-1 that we could play in here. So we have actually a lot of really quick 1-drops that we could play that are fair bodies, and as long as we can tempo and keep control of the board, then we might be okay. Another one that people were really excited about a very long time ago is from Set 1, where is he? I'm looking for him. Servant of Shethak. And so the thing is, like, in a deck like this, we should be able to get 20 different card names because we have to have 10 different troop types. The problem is he doesn't help us towards our other thing. So we'll consider him. Ancestors Chosen is another one we could probably one of in here. That is a fairly good card. Let's see if there's anything else. We got Technomancer, might be interesting as well as a 1-drop. You play an artifact, create a Dreadling. We're not going to have enough artifacts to make that happen. Okay. Yeah, for some reason I thought that guy was did things all by himself and we didn't need to support him with other cards. Yeah, you can't play cards that need other support cards if that's going to change your whole deck, right? We got to stay focused with the deck. I don't know that we want to play any other card draw besides Lanpa's Sight. What can we do with this guy? This Depth Crawler. That's another one we could throw something on. Well, he's really not worth it, though. He's not Ardent. I don't see myself doing this. Now, I have seen people play it in Limited, though, and thrown some extra, whatever they're called, on them. Some extra, I forget what they're called, the Dreadlings. There we go. Soul Marble is going to be too slow for the deck. I can just see that being way too slow for the deck. Martyr could be interesting for the deck, so we'll consider that for now. Pride's Fall, maybe that's more of a reserves card just because there's just so many dinosaurs out there. Pride's Fall takes care of Crocosaur really, really well, which is pretty cool. It's nice to be able to just say, oh, you're going to battle two of my troops? No, you're not, right? Because you're going to be flooding the board with troops, and so you really need to be able to Pride's Fall stuff away. Void all the Banes. I don't really see Purify making the deck because there's really just not a lot of Banes going around these days. A lot of times when you're figuring out stuff, you just have to look at what the metagame is and what your chances are of playing some of the higher end decks and what kind of things they do main deck, because you have to respond to their main deck plan, right? Frost Wizard is another one I like to have, like, as a one of in the main deck possibly, and maybe more in the reserve. So we'll put one in both, but we'll see if he makes the final deck. Totem's not really going to work for us. Shinobi might work for us. This one actually might be amazing in this deck because we're really trying to tempo so hard, and exhausting a troop and being able to swing through is kind of important. Protectorate Defender is another one that's made a big comeback lately, too. Being that we can throw the gem where basically all your stuff gets bigger when he swings. Not that one. When it attacks, it gets flight this turn. No, not that one. And then this one. When it attacks, ready each Ardent troop you control, and troops with Ardent get +1/+1. Yeah, that's going to be his gem. Pious Paladin is kind of interesting, too. I don't know that it makes the deck, though. Problem with some of these is they're double diamond, and so maybe that might be why they don't make the deck, because odds are we're trying to not do what they do. Controller's hand. So we should probably look up maybe controller's hand, see if there's any other tempo that we're missing that we should consider. Controller's hand. Okay, so we've got Crackling Tide, which is just put a target card in its controller hands and then gain a charge, which could be good with Marshal Josephina. I mean, Time Ripple kind of does that better, arguably, but this gets us closer to using our champion power, which lets us tempo. So running 8 of these tempos might be good. It's hard to say. Put target troop in its controller's hand. It gets, when this enters play, each opposing champion puts a troop from their hand into play. Wait a minute. Put target troop in a controller's hand. It gets, when this enters play, each opposing champion puts a troop from their hands into play. That seems ridiculous, because for what we're trying to do with this deck, we have these angels that cost 8 that are going to be sitting in our hand, which are going to have a hard time coming into play. And if we paradigm shift something, especially if it's like a Carnosaurus, he's going to be like, oh, do I play this Carnosaurus or not? Oh, what could he have? And then you end up with this massive angel on the board. Maybe this is what we're trying to do. Like, this card, I don't know. I wouldn't say that it's completely broken, but it definitely, it feels like a huge deterrent, if anything, or it's a real risk for your opponent, unless they've seen your hand, which is what blood players can do. So maybe in the blood matchup it's less good, but you know, just looking at this in a void and thinking about what could happen, you know, the best of what could happen, it feels like it could be ridiculous, but maybe there are a lot of other situations where it just kind of falls on its face. Playing something like this also is going to push us into Sapphire more than Diamond, because it's got that double Sapphire, and we really want that to happen. Of course, we'll look at some of our counter magic and stuff as well. You know, counter magic has kind of been still going to be a staple in everybody's deck if you're playing Sapphire. I don't know that we play this. So we got 130 cards to whittle down here to 60 somehow. So let's get cracking on that. That is basically where we're going to be at. We already talked about this guy. We're going to go ahead and gem him for the Ardent. So Diamond of the Ardent. So we definitely want that guy. I think that I can just simply go through, and I really want to play this Sapphire card. After seeing Paradigm Shift, I really want to play it. And so we're just going to say we're playing Diamond, you know, little diamond, big sapphire type of a deck. So anything double diamond right now, I think I'm just going to simply just squash out of the deck right now, so just to help us out. So that means Shinobi has to go, and William Rowan has to go right away. That kind of puts a tier, right? And Bring to Justice I don't like anyways. I don't know that Clash of Steel is doing what we want to do in this deck, actually. So we're going to go and get rid of that. The Solitary Exile, I'm going to leave for now. But we may revisit that, because it is fairly slow and may not be doing exactly what we want to do here. The Counter Magic, maybe it's possible that the, what's it called, is better, actually. The Waylay might be better in this deck than the Counter Magic. It's hard to say. I do like the idea of playing 8 counter magic, but that's not really... But in an aggro deck, I don't know that... Maybe we just try to play 2 Waylay and no counter magic. Maybe that's what we try to do and see what happens there. Because we are trying to play troops every turn, and so, you know, if we can play... If we have 4 resources in play, we can still play our troops for 2. Or if we have 5, we can play, like, Hero Legend or something like that. I do still want to play the Vanquisher, so even though it costs 2 diamonds, we're gonna attempt that. I don't know that I'm going to play 4 of them, though, although I probably want to. troop attacks, this is in your hand, it gets cost minus one. I mean, it feels like this is what we're trying to do, right? So, yeah, I think we keep this thing in and just go for it. Silver Talon Adjudicator might have to go down. The Elder Streamer might have to go down. Reese is just way too slow for what we're trying to do, which is get the Vanquisher in play. I like the Buccaneers. Those definitely stay. Mentalist. Let's see. What else have we got here? I like Mentalist with Den Mother. I like that little combo, of course. And then also Mirror Knight plus Den Mother is good as well. And then also Crusader plus Mirror Knight and Mentalist. So all those things feel like they work together fairly well. Hero Legend is a really nice body, though, so maybe I can try to hang on to him. We definitely don't want this Servant anymore. I don't want anything that's honestly not Ardent, so I do like Totem still. But it just doesn't... It's not Ardent. It doesn't do very much for me, so maybe we'll get rid of that one. We actually have 2-2. That's for one. This, I'm not sure if that's okay. It does have flight. It is doing, it is attacking every turn, and if they don't have flight, that could be difficult to deal with. And it trades with Carnosaurus, and it trades with a lot of things in Ruby. You know, both of these guys do. So maybe we're okay with that for now. The Ancestor Chosen. Let's see, how many Ardent troops do we have right now? I'm just going to pull this Martyr. I don't think that we want that, actually. I think we want to be as aggressive as possible in here. And that's actually going to make things worse for us. Let's see. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. We've got 12, 13 Ardent troops. We're actually over budget on Ardent troops, so we can definitely go down on those if we have to. So I think I'm just going to, just for the ease of keeping things simple, we're just going to get rid of some of the one-ofs right now. The Frost Wizard, and the Ancestor Chosen. We don't really need those one-ofs right now. This seems pretty good. Warparty Guide seems pretty good. Maybe we'll go down to... I always end up going down to at least like 3 Time Ripple is what it seems like. Tomeseeker I like a lot in this deck. So even though it's not an Ardent troop, I really like it still because it gets bigger and our opponent doesn't want to deal with it. Or maybe they do and they just can't. Elder Streamer does what we're trying to do, which is attack. So that's a big deal. Adjudicator I like. Maybe we'll put one of these on the reserves or something. Maybe we only go down... Maybe we go down to 3 Mentalist. Maybe we only play 3 Mirror Knight in here. Let's see. Where are we at right now? We're at 92 cards. I need to get rid of 32 cards right now. 32 cards. That's a lot of cards. I like all these cards so much. Let's look at what the curve is doing. Our 3-point range could use some work. The 4-point range might as well. Maybe we'll just, you know what, we won't go too crazy with the Vanquisher. We'll just go with 2 of these just to help us build things out a little bit better. Maybe just 2 Silver Talon. Maybe just 2 of those. If it's going to respond. Okay, we need to refresh our page. We got like 7 minutes left in the show, so we'll see if we can finish out here. Do stick around. I think I do have enough packs to give away a draft this for the live show. People on YouTube, I will do a drawing for you as well. I will notify you, so don't worry too much about that. I did not do it at the beginning of the show, which I should have, but you'll get something. I don't know if it's going to be a draft. I have to look at how much I've got. Lompaw Sight may be a little bit too slow for this deck as well. Yeah, maybe we're just not even caring that much about drawing cards, honestly, with like Lompaw Sight. Maybe it's an okay one of just because we can bounce things and that's cute. You know, maybe, and it's not too cute, but it's cute enough. It's a cutie. I like the Paradigm Shift. It's hard to say how good this is, though. I want to say this is amazing because I can put things into play. A lot of my stuff has into play abilities. Like, so here's the thing. Like, my opponent plays a card. I bounce it with Paradigm Shift. It is basic action speed. Then they replay it. Then I put Buccaneer in play and bounce it again. I mean, that line of play is tempo. Like, that's the annoyance of tempo right there. So maybe we're looking for more things with come into play abilities just because we have so much tempoing going on here. So maybe, even though Hero Legends is a really good body, we're going to go and bust him down. Ardent Crusader is fine, though. This guy's fine. He takes care of my stuff that dies. This guy needs to attack to do stuff. And that guy, when he attacks... Which guy's better? War Party guy? Now that I've gotten rid of my card draw, I think we need the War Party guy, but maybe less Protectorate Defender. Because he's good, but not, like, you know, stupendous. I think we need... I don't think we need Valiant Escort as much as we need this Cloud Runner, actually. So we're actually going to do that. We can't play Cloud Runner on one, which is disappointing, but playing Valiant Escort on one... I don't know. Maybe I want one. Let's see if I'm out of range, and I'll put him back. Let's see. One, two of my Ardent troops, that is. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. So, yeah, I need him back. So that was... I forgot what his name is. This is what happens, right, when you start rushing. Oh, boy. I got to look for him. I need to turn off all the other cards. Should have left one in or moved him to the reserves. Where are you? You're here. I'm getting close. I can feel it. I'm getting close. This is why you want to memorize the names of the cards, by the way, so you can find things more easily and save yourself time. One Valiant Escort. Okay, so that's fine. So we can play him on one, and you know he's a one drop that we can play on one. Whereas the other one's not. I don't know. Maybe Cloud Runner's not as good as I think it is. So maybe I should be getting rid of those. Maybe take those down to one as well. That's my other one of. Sure. Protector Defender at two. War Party Guides drawing cards. Really Mirror Knights drawing cards. Forbidden Tomeseeker drawing cards. Dead Mother takes the buffs. It's not going too bad, Ragnarok. I'm just trying to finish this deck out right now. We're trying to play Righteous Vanquisher by tempoing. And I've really started to take a shine to this paradigm shift. I'm not sure how good it is, but it seems like it should be fairly good. I like the Tomeseeker. Especially when we're tempoing, our opponent's going to draw cards, you know. We could go down one resource, but we still need to get rid of 12 cards, so we got to figure out what's not working for us right now. I know, it's decisions you have to make, right? So a lot of that stuff's probably going to be on our curve, so we'll go and refresh the page here and see if we can get a good curve. Sometimes the bar chart at the top kind of gets messed up, so yeah. You can see that the white reflection of the screen on my face as I refresh the page. I look way whiter. So we've got a lot of 3 drops and 2 drops. So probably in the 3 drops and 2 drops is where we're going to be looking to make cuts. I think we still want 2 Waylay in here. Maybe only one. You know what? Maybe it's too hard to play. So we'll go with one just in case. But it may be more amazing than I thought. I still like Tomeseeker. I don't know that I want 4 of them. Let's go down with 2 of those. We'll see how that goes, because it's another one that buffs the other cards. But it's ridiculous all by itself. It just takes time to build up, that's all. Let's see. I like the paradigm shift so as well, but we'll go down to 3 of those just in case. Like, the thing I really like, again, is you paradigm shift your opponent, and you happen to have Vanquisher in hand, and then they play the card, and you play Vanquisher. It just seems pretty ridiculous. You know what? We actually, with Adjudicator and War Party Guide, we may have enough card draw that we just don't even worry about Long Pause Sight at all. So I think maybe we can just deal without even playing that, honestly. Especially with the amount of bounce. I can bounce Adjudicator back with, you know, any number of cards. I've got Time Ripple. I've got... Buccaneer. Looks like I don't think that the new card that we've got does it, though. Let's see. Put target troop into its control. Yeah, even Paradigm Shift does it. The problem with Paradigm Shift is if I do it to my own guy, then my opponent gets to play a card, so that seems really bad. So you're probably only going to want to Paradigm Shift your opponent's stuff, most likely. Let's see. I want the War Party Guide. I don't think we can go down on those. I don't think that's negotiable. So maybe Paradigm Shift is not as good as I thought it was. I want to play this Vanquisher. I want to play more than just one in the deck. Ugh. We got to play two Vanquisher. We totally started on Vanquisher. At least two is required if we're going to try to attempt this deck. Maybe we go down a little bit on Eldritch Dreamer to like three. Maybe we'll go down to three on that. We definitely want four of those. Mentalist, we want two. That guy, I want two. This guy, this guy. What are we throwing on Ardent Crusader, by the way? I think we throw the Flight Gem, right? That's pretty much the typical standard thing that we do. Diamond of Wind gets flight and all that fun stuff. Because it only takes that or the plus two defense. I mean, the plus two defense is good too, so I don't know. I would fault anyone for doing that one. I still want the Mirror Knights. I want three of those. Man, this is hard. Okay, maybe one less Protectorate Defender. Kind of just in the one-ofs mode now. We got five cards left we need to get rid of to make this happen. Okay, Solitary, I'm going to go down on you. We'll go down one Solitary, just because it's really hard to cast. You know what? We'll just eliminate those. It's too hard to cast, possibly, because we are playing more into Sapphire than we are into Diamond, even though we have double Diamond Vanquisher. But it really doesn't matter what the threshold is. If we Paradigm Shift and our opponent's foolish enough to play their card, then there's a chance we'll just play this thing anyways, because it just says, play the card. But the just choose each opposing champion puts a troop from their hands into play, and that says to me that I get to choose. So I don't know, this might be broken, or it may catch dumb people off guard at least. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's like the very least of that one. It should at least catch some people that are not ready for it off guard. Some people like to say steal games. I don't usually like to say that. That seems a little bit ridiculous to me. There's no such thing as a stolen game. It's just the games that you lose because you just either didn't draw well or you made bad choices, right? It's not like it was unfair. We're going to go down one more Eldritch Dreamer to just kind of smooth out that four-point part of our curve. We kind of split the difference on Eldritch Dreamer and Silver Talon, so maybe you want one of these or the other one, or if you only have four of one of them, then maybe just choose that. Again, with the Eldritch Dreamer, we gemmed it so that way we could make it our opponent's stuff mostly useless by subtracting their front end every time he attacks. So they'll either deal no damage to us when they get to attack, or we'll be able to attack into them freely. Maybe one less Paradigm Shift. I really like this card. I think I'm just going to go down one Time Ripple, although that may be a bad choice. So we'll do that. We'll go down one Time Ripple. And there we go. There is the deck. Probably not a competitive deck. I do need to fix the shard base. We are actually 3 minutes over on the episode. Oh, you know, I just got rid of all my diamond shards. I need to fix that. But we will go ahead and close out the episode after I put these diamond shards back in. They're down here. Yeah, we actually are not too heavy in diamonds. We've got enough humans. I think we should be okay. So we probably want 5 and then 7 sapphire. 7, I think. I think that's what we... Or wait, we want 5, 6. Yeah, something like that. And, you know, honestly, like our threshold fixing is pretty ridiculous. We may not actually even need to play the Shard of Purpose in here. So maybe one less of those and play another Sapphire Shard just because... You know, we need to be able to play cards on time in the deck most of the time, more than we need to fix things. So tonight on Deck with the Squire, we built this. Actually, kind of came together right at the end there. We built this pretty cool deck for Righteous Vanquisher. Probably not that competitive, but it does do some interesting things. It does a lot of bouncing, which may be better just because there's so many Crusaders running around and Hierophants and other things that... bouncing is definitely, it does buy you time, at least against them. It's just bad against dinosaurs, really. We talked about the Adventure Zone 2, which is we're getting before Christmas, and the fact that we're getting some mercenaries and some other promises, stuff that's way back from the Kickstarter days. We talked about the fact that the Season 2 is getting ready to end, so you want to get stuff in. And of course, this weekend is the weekend for all of the VIP members, so make sure that you're getting out to play your VIP and use your tickets. I just got kind of surprised on that one, so it's always a surprise for me. It shouldn't be by now, but it always is, the VIP weekend. But yeah, I'm going to have to get out and play some VIP tomorrow, and that was pretty much the show tonight. So again, Thanks for stopping by, and this is Aaron Squire signing off, saying God bless your family. Strive to rage too much out there.